Today's cyber risk threat surface continues to expand on an exponential basis. Governments, private sector organizations, NGOs, they're all challenged by actors that may include nation states, criminal organizations, hacktivists, ideologically driven groups, as well as individuals. Many of the actors are well-funded. They have advanced capabilities that certainly outpace the ability of most organizations to counter them. The purpose of our discussion this morning is to examine the global state of cybersecurity. And with our esteemed panel members today, I think we would like to approach it by breaking it out into certain modules. The first module, we will actually want to discuss cyber threats themselves. What do we see in the current environment today? We will then want to talk about the ability of organizations globally to be resilient in the face of the threats that we see. In other words, if we can all agree that most organizations today are susceptible to a potential attack or breach, what is the readiness of an organization to be able to bounce back, to maintain their operations, their continuity of business, continuity of government in the face of the threats? And also, in order to become resilient, it will require us to have governance structures within our own organizations, within our individual countries, and certainly on a global basis in order to make progress and ensure that we can become more cyber secure well into the future. Finally, today, we would like to suggest some ongoing principles towards becoming more cyber and secure and resilient for the future. So we will have some ideas that we will present to you, and certainly we will want to hear from you in the audience today as well, and take in your contributions. Jim has been very clear. This conference is not just about talking about the problem on an ongoing basis, but working towards solutions on a global basis. The internet has no borders, so we need to address this from a global perspective. So again, thank you for being here, and now we'll move on to the program. So first, I'd like to throw a question to our friend Joe. Joe is now the Vice President for the federal sector at Assured Enterprise Solutions. And as you heard from his introduction, the former cyber intel chief for the Pentagon, he has particular insight into what's going on in the threat environment. And Joe, if you could open up our discussion today with what you see are both the rising risks and what elements impact the ability for the threats that are out there to actually be successful.
Well, thank you very much, Chris, and glad to be here, honored to be here among such esteemed colleagues. When we talk about trends in internet security, when we talk about trends in threat, we have to start with motive. And I want to offer a couple of initial statistics from the Verizon 2016 Data Breach Investigation Report. In that report, Verizon discovered that 75 to 80% of breaches involved a financial motive, i.e. criminals looking to score money, score a quick financial gain. 10 to 12% were described as having espionage, theft of secrets as a motive. Those would principally be state actors, are what we typically term advanced persistent threat, APTs. And then the remainder were some of the other categories that Chris had mentioned before. Hacktivists with an ideologic motive, vandals simply looking to cause trouble, and then a number that were unknown motives. So when you begin that 90% of the breaches involved either a financial motive and criminals or state sponsors seeking secrets, that should frame how you're thinking about your own security, because it really goes back to looking for where your value may be hidden. What you need to understand is that hacking is a business, and it's one of the most competitive businesses in the world. And I'll offer two more quick statistics on how the financial motive changes the way hackers behave. 5 years ago, if you were a hacker and you wanted to steal personal records, say perhaps the registration information for this conference, getting names, addresses, phone numbers, potentially credit card information, without the credit card information, you might get $1 per record. Today, if you were to try and make money stealing the same information, you might get 5 cents. I've heard as low as 3 cents per record. It is very difficult simply pursuing those approaches to have a successful environment. So what do hackers do? Well, they simply change motive. If your market is becoming mature and you're no longer responsive, move to new places. So where is the threat moving? Well, 2016 was very much the year of ransomware. Now, for those of you that aren't familiar, ransomware involves a payload where if you click on, say, an attachment in a suspicious email, the payload will proceed to encrypt any data that you had access to, and then it usually leaves a nice little text file behind that's your ransom note that tells you how to go on to the Onion router, how to go on to dark websites and pay a ransom in Bitcoin. We've seen two major variants of this. One is very targeted, boutique, if you will, going after large organizations, as happened to Hollywood Presbyterian Medical Center in Los Angeles. They had their entire system overrun by ransomware and paid a ransom of about $20,000, roughly 50 bitcoins, to get it unlocked. In February of this year, we saw Locky, which was the first, if you will, retail or direct appeal of ransomware, which was being downloaded at the rate of 100,000 copies per day. It only had a ransom of half a Bitcoin, rough to, and in some cases, one Bitcoin, $250, maybe $400. But the point was a broad appeal. If the people behind Locky simply had 1,000 people pay the ransom, they would have earned $250,000. So it is big business, and they understand that. Bitcoin, of course, is the preferred payment method for this because it is relatively difficult to trace and is easy enough to actually execute over some instructions. Mobile is another big area. You will have seen the update that that Apple did to iOS to version 10 that was deliberately designed to cover a flaw that would have allowed you to remotely jailbreak an iPhone. Android platform has already had this problem, it being an open system. You have greater control over your own system, but that means if you say yes to something online, the hacker now has greater control of your system too. The big concern though is, remember, we see hackers looking for new sources of funding. The Internet of Things is going to open up a whole new realm of places for hackers to go after. As we interact through our phones to control our home security system, to control our car or to integrate with our car, to control functions at work, whether it is scanning, that is going to become the new venue for blackmail, for ransomware, other ways to try and gain money, because it provides a very poorly controlled nexus where anybody can be walking in with their cell phone trying to get access to a particular system. That now opens the door to having your car locked by ransomware, your home security system locked by ransomware, your medical devices affected by ransomware. It is a frightening future, but it's one that, as we will discuss in the rest of the panel, there are some very basic things you can do to understand where the risk is coming from and what you can do in respond. So my bottom line message for you is, you're worried about your hacking problem, follow the money. Where is the value lying that you're worried about, and that's what you should focus on protecting.
Well, thank you, Joe. And we're going to have a very open dialogue this morning, so we're going to hop around between our panelists this morning. Yanming, I'd like to have you spend a few moments in particular talking about the cyber threat as you see it from Asia. In particular, what type of collaborations do you see between organizations at the governmental level as well as at the NGO level in terms of dealing with the types of threats that Joe just mentioned? And certainly we would be interested in what you're seeing on an ongoing basis today.
Okay, do I have the slides, please? Oh, here. So, the slides, the control of the slides? No, nothing happened. Oh, okay, yeah. I'm going to give a brief overview of the cybersecurity in Taiwan. So, the next slide. So, like in most of the other countries in Taiwan, we have three layers of structures. At the top is a so-called National Information and Communication Security Task Force, directly to provide advices to the cabinet. And then at the second level is the National Security Operations Centers. And then at the bottom are the MSSPs. So the next slide. And then the next slide, please. Okay. Yeah, this is a very busy slide. However, it shows that at the top we have the cabinet level task force, so providing the government level of cybersecurity awareness. And then now we have different ministries cooperated together, forming different working groups concerning each technology development part, and also the cyberspace protection system, and also for investigation system, etc., and also for cyber infrastructure protection. Okay, the next slide, please. And this slide show you that the information exchange and analytics through this so-called GISEC mechanism. So we start with the constantly monitor for the APT, botnet, malware, and spam, etc. And these information are sent to the ISEC for further analysis and tracking. And then these information are shared among the government agencies and also for the industry and other agencies. Okay, next slide, please. So we can see that these are not enough yet, because so we all aware of in recent days, APT attack and botnet attack, they may put some of their agents into the servers of a specific service provider. However, it doesn't harm the server itself or the service itself. This is sort of for the attack attacking the global internet instead of just the single server. So for most people, they just don't care. We don't care. We don't know that we have this kind of botnet nodes within our servers. So the government in Taiwan is now in the process of drafting a new law and regulation. So that actually the business part is not that easy to touch, especially in a democratic country. So we start with the so-called cyber infrastructure protection. So as you can see on the your right-hand side, those are the eight, we identify the eight infrastructures that we are going to enforce further auditing and also further put further obligations on these service providers. The next one. And then, as you can see, the volume of information among this government, private sector, and public sector, you can see that these information keeps goes up and down, but still it's in a quite huge amount. Next, please. The regional, so we need to also cooperate with other countries in the region, and APEC is the major platform. And then we also have regular interactions with other countries in a bilateral format. We have contact with the GISEC of the states, and then with Japan, with Malaysia, with Korea, etc. Yeah, the next, please. Okay, the next. Anyway, this shows some statistics of the companies, percentage of companies they had this kind, they have suffered this kind of cyber attacks. So anyway, I'm going to skip this one. Let's move to the next. And anyway, the National Center for Cybersecurity Technology, recently they have put honey nets in the network so that they can measure and monitor those cyber attack traffics on the net. And they found that even the industrial control systems and IoT has become the target of network attacks. And these HoneyNet deployed by NCCST has identified that actually 28 million events detected and 50K malware per year in the last 3 years, mainly from the States, Russia, and China. And then in the year of 2016, we detected 180 million events, and then among them, 110K are found to be malware brute force attacks targeted at these IoT devices. And we can see that these attacks are becoming increasing dramatically. The next one. So this is the last slide. And as you can see, many of the end devices and also the major infrastructure equipments are the victims of these attacks, including web cameras, heat pump controllers, smart meters, IPC, DVR, Wi-Fi apps, set-top box, etc. So actually, it is found that the botnet is distributed across 156 countries. And there's NCCST, they have informed 18 about those national certs. Anyway, as we can see that the target of these attacks are actually in 160 of them are in Taiwan. So I will stop here. I will show the rest of the slides if we have time.
Very good.
Thank you.
Yuanming, thank you very much. We certainly appreciate your perspectives from what you see in Taiwan. What really struck me was your discussion, obviously, of critical infrastructure and the impact of cybersecurity on critical infrastructure. And obviously, that's one of the reasons we're having this discussion today. Well, what I'd like to do now is move to Summer Fowler. I've had the privilege to work with Summer for a number of years now. She's a technical director for risk and resilience at the CERT SEI at Carnegie Mellon University. And Summer, through the work that we've done together, I know that you are a big proponent of resilience when it comes to cyber. That as we talk about these threats, we have to understand that events are going to take place. So it would really be great, in addition to understanding your view on the threats, how prepared are we to be resilient, both for government agencies today across the globe, as well as within individual organizations and businesses? Summer, the floor is yours.
Thank you, and thank you so much for having me. It's my first time in Brazil, and it's been a wonderful trip. So good morning, and thank you for your hospitality. So how many of you in the audience are hearing what Joe and Jungming are saying and feeling a little hopeless? Right. We go to a lot of conferences, we talk to a lot of people, we read a lot of reports about the threat, and it changes. As Joe indicated, the threats evolve to follow the money. And so it can become a frustrating enterprise when we think about how are we going to stop these terrible things from happening. And so I want to shed a little optimism and say that it really isn't necessarily about stopping the bad guys from making attacks, and it's about focusing inward on your organizations and making them resilient, as Chris was saying, to the actual attacks. Resilience starts with an enterprise focus. Cybersecurity and resilience are not about information technology alone. It's really looking at your business and your business enterprise. So the good message is that even with your limited resources within your organizations, whether it's industry or government or some pseudo blend, you have in your hands the control over the resilience of your organization. It starts with looking at the mission. What is it that your organization wants to achieve? Are you in retail sales? Are you a banking organization? Are you a water municipality? What is the mission of your organization? And if you can sit down and have that discussion at the leadership level and say, these are the things that we need to achieve, then you can start to drive down to the most critical assets within your organization. So starting with that mission, you then look down to what are the services that I need to provide? What are the things that I need to be doing in order to achieve that mission? Then looking at that service, you can say, what are the assets that support those services. And the assets can be multiple things. It's not just data, it's not just tech, it's people, it's facilities, it's data, it's information. So it's looking across all of those different types of assets that support those services that provide you the mission that you want to achieve. Looking at that, you can then apply those limited resources that you have to protect those most critical assets. However, it's not just about protection. At Carnegie Mellon, we work a lot with the critical infrastructure of the United States through the Department of Homeland Security and other federal agencies. We also do a lot of work within industry. And I can tell you, we work with organizations that often are focused solely on protection. But we've heard the message. The threat is evolving. The threat is real. There are a lot of threat actors. And so we know bad things are going to happen. We have to have a balance between protection and sustainment. So when you're looking at your most critical assets within your organization, whether it's people, data, a facility, don't look at just how to protect it. Look at how you will sustain the operations when something bad does happen. And remember, when we're looking at this from an enterprise focus, we're not just looking at cyber threat. Other bad things can happen. Natural disasters. A mistake by a person. There's been a lot of buzz over the past several years about insider threat. My organization at Carnegie Mellon University has decades of experience in studying the insider threat. There are both malicious insiders, and then there are the unintended, the insider who actually just makes a mistake, and it creates a problem for your organization. So the message I want to send out is one of hope, instead of one of just the fear of the threat, that we do control the resilience of our organizations, starting with our mission, driving down to our assets, our most critical assets, and absolutely looking at a balance between protection and sustainment. And you know, as we continue today, we do really want to get questions from the audience and hear from you about your concerns or your questions about how to be a more resilient organization. And starting the dialogue today and continuing that with this organization. Thank you.
Well, Summer, thanks so much for your comments. And our next panelist, batting cleanup, as they would say from the U.S. baseball perspective, is Kirsten Nielsen, and someone else I've had the privilege to work for in both government and in the private sector. But Kirsten really comes to the table today with a truly global perspective. She serves as the Global Risk and Resilience Chair for the World Economic Forum and is working with world leaders in the public and the private sectors continually on these issues. Kirsten, you two are a huge proponent of resilience for organizations. But in order for us to become more cyber secure and resilient, that requires us to have processes for how we will essentially achieve our objectives. Governance is a huge issue, and it's also a huge problem today. So if you would maybe touch on some of those issues in addition to what you're seeing out there generally related to the threat and how we make some advancements today.
Thank you, Chris, and good morning to everyone. It's lovely to follow Summer, because after she just gave you a message of hope, I'm going to give you a little message of caution, and then we'll go back to the more hopeful. So as Chris said, to sort of combine everyone's comments on the panel so far, we have a very quickly evolving environment. So we've talked a little bit about the Internet of Things. We have cloud services continuing exponentially to be on the rise. We have big data. We have artificial intelligence. So the environment in which we're operating is changing quite quickly. Add to that digitization in general and the connectivity that we all have with each other, and suddenly we have a very hyper-connected, interdependent environment in which these cyber attacks are occurring. Just to name two other threats that we haven't really touched on yet, we talk a lot about the confidentiality of data, but there's also a big concern with respect to the availability and the integrity of data. You'll hear some speak about integrity from the concept of what if an attacker went into a hospital system and not only stole the data, but perhaps changed it. So now the blood types of all the patients are listed differently than what they are. Or, as Joe mentioned, what if they lock down the data so that the availability of blood type is not there? So confidentiality and integrity of data become very important. And then I wanted to spend one moment on systemic risk. We talked a bit about critical infrastructure. Jaming showed us that in Taiwan, there's 8 critical infrastructure sectors. In the United States, we have 16. And in various countries around the world, we think of critical infrastructure quite differently. But when this environment meets critical infrastructure, meets the attackers, we suddenly have events where there's a systemic risk, meaning that an attack on one entity can have cascading effects through many entities. So suddenly your concept of risk is quite different. Your risk is now my risk if we're connected. That's a very different place than we've traditionally been, where you can lock down your physical assets and protect them. Now my risk footprint, if you will, includes all of the potential places where a threat indicator can be introduced. So all of that takes us to governance, which is very important. How do we work together? What are the roles and responsibilities between the private sector, the public sector, various international organizations, academia, and owners and operators of critical infrastructure and private business? Whose role is it to prevent, to respond, to reconstitute, to enforce? We all play a role in this evolving environment. So just to touch on a few, right now, at least our studies show, there's about half of all United Nations members that either have in place or are developing cybersecurity legislation. So what that means, on one hand, is we are all recognizing there's a problem to address. On the other hand, without coordination, means that all of those who operate, all of us who operate as global citizens, face potential conflicts and actual risk when it comes to compliance. So as an international organization, if I'm complying with rules in the United States, they might not be the same as those in the EU or in Australia or Taiwan. So we have an alignment issue where, as an international community, we need to work together to agree on basic nomenclature, basic definitions, and to understand what it means to have a risk-based approach. Certainly, it can't be that the rules we need to protect social media are the same as those that we need to protect the electric grid. So our approach needs to be risk-based and really understand, as Summer was talking about, from an entity perspective, what is that essential function and mission which any given entity is providing. We also, Chris mentioned quickly regulation. Regulations are tough in this area. I will be the first to say, because of the pace of innovation, it's very difficult for government processes and bureaucratic systems to keep pace with both the threat attackers and our evolving environment. So as we look towards regulations, they need to be flexible, they need to be adaptable, they need to recognize that looking at any given problem of today and solving for that might have unintended consequences when we go to solve for tomorrow's problem. So the regulatory framework needs to be quite different than what we've looked at in the past. And then finally, I just want to touch on norms. A 2011 study from the United Nations showed that 33 members use the term cyber warfare in one of their national strategies, and that number has only grown since 2011. We really need to, as an international community, start to think about norms. You know, for example, one that is talked about quite often is, can we all agree as an international community at both the governmental level and the entity level that governments will not attack the critical infrastructure in other countries through cyber means? Is that a norm that we can have as an international community? So we have alignment issues at the basic legislation level. We have some questions about regulation and what is the best way to regulate when needed. Are there alternatives there? Voluntary standards and frameworks that we can promote and use. And then from the norms perspective, are there norms that we can all agree on to move forward into this brave new world where we are all so connected? And then the last point on governance is just, what is the role of the private sector? So we talk a lot about public-private partnerships. We've done a lot of work with the World Economic Forum and others on resilience. And what is the role that any given entity should play as a part of that to ensure that together we mitigate the risk that we have and understand what we can accept and what we can transfer? So we have some governance issues, but to put it on, to flip and to take a note from Summer, to be hopeful about it, what you are seeing is an evolution of this concept of partnership. There are more public-private partnerships, particularly to use information sharing as an example, exponential numbers compared to 4 or 5 years ago.
Well, Kirsten, your discussion of kind of how we need to harmonize global efforts on cybersecurity and resilience are really important. And the public-private partnerships that you're talking about will also be even more important as we move into the future. I think when you look at the threat surface, Yanming, I'd really like you to tell us a bit more about the public-private partnerships that you have established in Taiwan. Because as these threats continue to expand, we're going to need to have these governance structures in place. So what is working? What do you see working the best from your perspective in terms of making progress in that regard on governance?
Actually, in Taiwan, I think those businesses are small and medium-sized business, even the digital service providers. And usually, they want to save their money. And in addition, and people in Taiwan actually will not quite care about our privacy. Well, sometimes people thought that, well, even if my profile, my ID, my password are breached, so what? Yeah, we don't care quite much. Yeah, because people thought that these digital services, they're not about money, are not about your property, etc., your assets. However, if people start to use other more valuable digital services, like banking services, then they will be in real trouble. And due to the ignorance of privacy, I think most of the services, they don't care quite much about providing good cybersecurity protection for their clients. So that's a big problem. Actually, in my slides, which I did not show, actually shows that the market size of cybersecurity business in Taiwan is only 1.1, 1.2 billion. So it's a very, very small industry in Taiwan. So on the other hand, it has a very big opportunity of growth. And because of this kind of environment, people doesn't care about the cybersecurity that much. So we can see that Taiwan has become the major target of botnet deployment. So it's actually it endanger not just Taiwan internet itself. It's a threat of the global internet in large, by large, right? So I think in a democratic country, if the government is going to intervene, then we have to put the infrastructure beforehand. If we don't have the legal infrastructure, actually government could not do quite a lot to enforce the business to become more aware. But however, we have the three, I just mentioned that we have the three-layer structure. So we have government and then domain ISOC, domain SOC, and then we also have the MSSP. So I think on the one hand, maybe in the future, we need to interact more with the MSSP, the managed security service providers. We hope that they could take more responsibility. And then I think also the cybersecurity industry, they have to back up this infrastructure. However, I think the government is on the stage of strengthen the cyber infrastructure in Taiwan, as I just mentioned. So the first step is to put some Cybersecurity Act in work. I hope that that can be done within 1 year. And after that, we will enforce the critical infrastructure service providers to strengthen their cybersecurity protection. So I think that's the first step. And maybe later we can do more in the future, but we need some experience first.
And it really seems that an organization, again, whether it's a government or a specific agency within in government, or a business organization, that step of knowing where you are, having an initial assessment, is really important to where you stand today. Summer, you're really an expert in this regard, in terms of the term risk appetite. That's something that I know that you've spent a lot of time on that issue. So if you could you just give us a little bit in terms of a little primer on risk appetite and how that can actually help increase cybersecurity and resilience within an organization?
Absolutely. So risk appetite is a job of the executives within your organization, the leadership. If you don't have access to your executives, because I know often when people are at these conferences, they think, well, my executives don't listen. You can do this at a micro level at whatever sphere of influence and control that you have. So risk appetite is about establishing what it is that you are willing to accept, what you need to mitigate. It really is a way of looking at the security across the organization at an enterprise level, and looking at it in a traditional risk management fashion. So setting that risk appetite does mean that you have to know where you stand today. And that does mean you should be performing a risk assessment. The market right now is flooded with various risk assessments. So it is a matter of deciding which assessment you're going to use, making a commitment and saying, for our business, this is the risk assessment we should be looking at. It needs to be an enterprise focus. Again, this is not just looking at information technology and cybersecurity. It's looking at the business as an organization. And then realizing that you are going to accept some risks. You can't cover everything. As I said before, we have limited resources. And so we have to get comfortable with the fact that there are some risks that we're going to accept. But it's understanding that throughout the entire organization. The panel talked last night about the fact that we need to have organizations establish cultures of risk. And so you have to foster the culture of security. I mean, fostering a culture of security within your organization. And that's been done in other industries for other things. The nuclear industry has a culture of safety. Absolutely, you know, from the top to the bottom, everyone within the organization thinks about safety. When we think about Six Sigma and when that came out, fostering from the top to the bottom, the goals of the organization. So establishing a risk appetite and then fostering that culture of security and making sure that everyone from, you know, the top of the organization to the people at the bottom of the organization understand what their roles and responsibilities are within security is very important. As Joe noted, ransomware is on the rise, but we still know that social engineering is one of the most common and most prevalent ways of organizations being attacked successfully. Social engineering is a people issue, not an IT issue. And so fostering that culture and having the policies in place and then the training in place for your organization is very important. It's a very important step in the risk appetite and how you're going to handle it.
I'm just going to jump in briefly to sort of echo a couple points that Summer made. When you look at a lot of risk management frameworks and other documents that are available out there intended to guide organizations in doing this, it can be overwhelming. The reality is it's actually not that very hard. If you can sort of stave off the intimidation of seeing something complex, this is one of the things I'm doing in my new role with my new company, is we're trying to get organizations to understand that it really can be a very simple process of taking an inventory of where you are in terms of the maturity of your program, understanding how far you've made progress on the technical side in terms of controls, and then understanding really who's likely to come against you. You can actually build a very effective construct for managing your own risk and understanding what you will be facing. But the central point is that it comes back to people. You can look up different estimates, but I personally believe the higher end estimates that 90% of these breaches and infections are beginning with an individual user. There may be a small percentage of cases that are, you know, malicious insiders that intended to cause a problem, but more often than not, it is someone accessing a corporate resource or accessing an organization resource from a cell phone, from a home browser. They click on something, that malicious link either takes them to a website or the document itself opens up malware, and that then is the initial foothold. All of the other fancy work that hackers do in terms of gaining root access, examining the network, doing the reconnaissance, it all begins with, most of the time, a single user granting them the initial foothold. So that is your best buy is investing in people and helping them to understand they have a central role to play in building a culture of security and managing the risk for the organization. It takes everybody as part of a team to make it work, and each organization has to communicate that from the leadership on down.
Kirsten, you're working on these issues on a global basis, and as Joe and Summer were just talking about, within an organization, really having an understanding of where you are is critically important. But kind of back to the broader scale, given the global nature of this conference, do we have, from an organizational standpoint, whether it be the World Economic Forum, the United Nations, et cetera, do we have a lot more work to do in regard to understanding risk much more broadly and how we get to resilience?
It's a good question. I think the short answer is yes, but I think that's a reflection of the complexity that we're facing. I think what we've all suggested in different ways is that the risk is not as easy, putting easy in quotes, as looking at what you physically control. And it's even more than, as Summer said, you start with your mission and your own assets, but it is a situation where you need to look at third parties, you need to look at your suppliers, you need to look at customers. Because the internet has no borders, as you mentioned, it quickly becomes a global risk issue. And to the extent that we're hyper-connected, your risk can be based on risk that's in Taiwan, as Huming said, if you're in the United States. So it is a global problem, and the complexity is such that to truly understand my risk, I do need to understand your risk. So the head-in-the-sand approach that sometimes has worked in physical risk management, meaning I'm going to get guards, I'm going to build gates, I'm going to have security measures at my physical location, does not work when it comes to cyber. So I think the complexity really leads to a situation where we do have a lot of work to do together just in understanding the risk. And just to touch on the systemic aspect again, we won't be aware of the single points of failure. We won't be aware of aggregated dependencies, complex interdependencies until we have that conversation. But all of those lead to the potential for systemic failures that could trickle throughout the world, right, in an extreme situation. But we're not that far away because the possibility is there.
Well, and one of the issues to making advancements is simply because there will be disagreement from a policy perspective on some of the major issues regarding cybersecurity. Privacy is one of those issues. So all of you have seen this, given the roles that you played. Certainly Joe has been a chief privacy officer from a government perspective before in relation to civil liberties and the like. So I'm going to open this up to the entire panel. I think this is a really important question. Are we in an age now where security and privacy need to be exclusive of one another, given the nature of the cyber environment?
I'll jump in first as the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board veteran from the U.S. government. I think what you have to understand when you look at the approach that we've all been talking about, it is systemic. It is looking in general terms about an organization. And for me, when I look at security as an issue, when I look at privacy as an issue, these are factors to which I must assign a value. I cannot have perfect security. I must understand, based on the value of my assets, how much I am willing to spend and place on security as a value when designing my system. Privacy plays the same role from a national standpoint in terms of privacy and civil liberties. When you want to assign a value to it, well, we have some standards that come from the government, we have some standards that come from our legislature, but again, you can't get to perfect privacy and give absolute control because the system isn't actually structured to do that. If I wanted to give everyone in this room the ability to control how much of their information is released on the internet, I would actually have to re-architecture every single system we use out there because it would have to collect all that information on you to give you the option to turn it all off. So the challenge here is in a system of systems environment, you need to assign value. Privacy and security don't have to be in conflict. It's only in how we structure their application inside a system.
Summer, do you have any thoughts on that?
Absolutely. I agree with you. Privacy and security are not exclusive of each other. I am not a privacy expert, but I can tell you that in looking at the things, the concepts that we have been talking on the stage today that have to do with risk assessment and protection of your organization, privacy is an element of those things. So when you are looking at your mission and when you are looking at what is important to your organization, privacy becomes something that you need as a consideration inside of that. But they are absolutely not exclusive of each other. There's no decision to be made, security versus privacy versus capability.
And there's just the one thing that I would add, when we think about resilience, we do advocate that everybody take a role. And privacy is a place where individuals can play a very important role. You know, the privacy rights and the privacy descriptions on any given app can be quite complex, I'm the first to say. Every time I update my software system or download a new app, I find that all of my privacy settings have been reset. However, you are, as an individual consumer, you do have the options to help protect your own privacy by really thinking through what value it is to you and what you're willing to give up for it. So I do encourage, on an individual basis, as part of resilience and to add to your own privacy, don't expect someone to protect it for you. You can play a role in your own protection by what you download and what privacy you opt into or opt out of.
And in some of our discussions, Yanming, you had mentioned that the view on privacy will change depending on which part of the world in which you live. And that can also influence the process as well, does it not?
Well, I think in Taiwan we do have a Privacy Protection Act, although it's not functional quite well, because sometimes the law enforcers, when they identify some privacy breaches, they will say that these companies, they are too small, and then the salary of those service, I mean, should say that the service engineers, well, is too low. So they feel sorry to punish them. So that's a real situation, I think, in Taiwan and maybe in other countries. So people does not take responsibility or take accountability for cybersecurity protection. I think that's quite a pity, I should say that, because I mentioned that although that Taiwan is not, Taiwan who's going to attack other countries. However, because I just mentioned that the botnet operators, they try to build their bots into every possible service. So that kind of threat is to the global internet. So if, each individual service provider is not privacy aware, they don't do the protection well, then the whole digital economy will be unstable.
Well, thanks for that. And one of the reasons we raised the issue of privacy and injected into this conversation, because it can be one of the sticking points, just as Yanming had mentioned, these are global issues. Yet we can have this disagreement, and it becomes a barrier to actually making progress in terms of security and resilience. And so it's critically important that we focus on this, because having some form of global governance, we believe, is really going to be critical to actually making progress versus constantly chasing the threats around on a regular basis. So we're coming towards the end of the hour, and as a panel, you will see on the slide that we have here, we have essentially put together some calls to action. Hopefully you heard this morning the basis for these calls to action, because as Jim had mentioned to us, we really want to get to a point where we are looking at a way to ensure that next year and the year after that, we're actually making progress on some of these issues, regardless of how difficult they may be, regardless how the technological threats advance, regardless of the difficulty from a political situation. So I'm quickly going to touch on each of the points, and certainly open it up for the floor of my fellow panelists to throw in some of their observations on these calls to action. And then we will want to open the floor to you. So the first that you see there is that organizations must be committed to enterprise assessment. And I can't stress enough that the calls to actions you see here are intended to apply to any type of organization, whether they be a government, a subgroup of a government, a private sector organization, or to individuals. Starting with a true and genuine enterprise assessment, that is not just the IT components. As we've talked about, there are a lot of human elements that come to play. You know, education, for example, in terms of implementing a culture of cyber resiliency. The focus on resilience for that culture and implementing a cybersecurity culture. Critically important that that there is a focus on how that will be achieved. And whether it's through the policies of a nation or the policies of a business, that has to be in place. Otherwise, you can't implement that culture. The third is resilience being an integral part of the cyber posture. If we can all agree that attacks will take place, are you prepared to be resilient? We all certainly view resilience as something that's lacking in organizations. Again, we are constantly chasing the threat rather than looking how to be resilient regardless of where the threat may originate. And then finally, we have to establish metrics so that we can measure progress and the maturity of an organization. These don't seem like overly complex types of concepts, and they're not. They shouldn't be, but they can allow each organization to look at their posture individually. I think sometimes it is a bit like boiling the ocean to think about cybersecurity threats today and how we manage them. And in our discussions, we see that we're starting at the big picture without looking at the building blocks we need to actually become more secure and resilient. If every organization begins looking at these concepts, we can have those building blocks so the larger discussions can take place. And so that's where we're wanting to go to today. So any thoughts from you on these calls to action?
Is my mic on? Oh, great. So I do want to jump in on this, and looking specifically at number four, measuring progress and maturity. There's a lot of questions about what we should be measuring, how do we measure it. And when we think about the spirit of resilience, we can talk a lot about what attacks are happening and what we've done to attacks and report back to our management about what we've stopped and what we haven't stopped. This slide is really about getting back to the basics. I can tell you that we are failing at the basics. We know that most attacks are happening with known vulnerabilities right now, the majority of attacks. I can also tell you that organizations do not know their most critical assets. We have performed, through Carnegie Mellon University, we've performed almost 500 assessments of the critical infrastructure within the United States. That's looking across all of the sectors. We've been in every state. We've been to all different sizes of organizations, from the biggest bank you can imagine down to fish and wildlife organizations. But we've done 500 of them. What I can tell you is that across the board, about 70% of organizations know what their services are to achieve their mission. Less than 50% of organizations can identify the critical assets that support those services. If we don't know the critical assets to protect, how can we become a resilient organization? So when you're looking at measurements, it needs to be focused inwardly before you even start looking at the threat. The threat is important, and it's important to make sure that that's a consideration. But something to start with measuring in your organization is, do I know all of my critical assets? That's a great first measure, and you might be surprised that you don't know them, and it's a good jumping off point.
I just wanted to jump in really quickly on resilience, just to make sure that we leave you with the difference we're trying to articulate between resilience and traditional risk management. Resilience is not a destination, right? It's the process. Resilience is something where we accept failure, we tolerate failure, and we innovate towards what is happening in the moment, right? So it's a very flexible, adaptive approach that's quite different than traditional risk management, where you have a plan, you implement your plan, you prevent the attack. This is not that. The key to resilience, therefore, is partnering. So if we prepare individually, we will fail collectively. Right? So it's a very different approach, both in terms of expectations and underlying assumptions of the threat. So I just leave you with that resilience. What we're trying to articulate here in number three is a different approach to preparing and preventing and responding than we traditionally have had.
And that's certainly why, from a global perspective, we need to get a handle on governance. Issues regarding regulation, enforcement, et cetera, there are multiple paradigms, hundreds actually, if you look at the environment today. And if we can take something, again, out of today's discussion, it is how do we get organizations across the globe to harmonize on these issues so we can make advancements in our individual countries. So with that, we'll wrap up the discussion. Certainly want to thank the panelists, but we would now like to, we have time for a couple of questions, and I'm not sure where the mics are on the floor, and then we will do our best to answer your questions.
Thank you very much. Stan from Malaysia. Some of you touched on two important points just now about risk attitude and assessment and also social engineering. But I know that there's another third component which I think is very key, which is identity management in organization. Because 80% of the hacking is done internally than externally, because many companies out there today put a lot of firewalls and additional locks to protect them from being hacked. But little did they realize sometimes the problem is inside but not outside. Your comments on that?
Absolutely. Identity management is one of those fundamental building blocks of being a resilient organization. And so when you think about, you're exactly right, there are often times that the problem is actually on the inside. So what I have my understanding what assets that you have and how to protect and sustain them, it's knowing who has access to them. And limiting that to only those who must have the access. That's where we're curious. When you are an interconnected organization, it's often going to be an issue that it's not just someone inside, it's someone who's in Taiwan, for example. But looking at the assets that you have that are most critical and limiting that and knowing who the identities are of who is accessing that is critical. It's one of the fundamental concepts inside of resilience.
And just to jump in on that point, when you look at what happened to Target stores in the United States, that was exactly the pattern that happened. It began with a phishing attack on a subcontractor that then gained access through Target's portal that then opened everything else up. It wasn't really even an individual at Target that was the problem, it was a third party on the outside.
Joe, and we'll take, I think we've got time for another question from the floor.
Hi, is this on?
DARPA recently completed their 2016 Cyber Brain Challenge, and it's focused on autonomous response systems. Thoughts on promise of that capability?
I'll just jump in quickly and then defer. I just as a high-level talking point, you know, the threat is moving so quickly that to pretend that we have time to do anything but automate our response, you know, misunderstands the threat. So I do think in general, the more that we see, and Summer certainly has lots of experience in this on CERT, but the more that we have both automated threat indicator sharing, the more we have countermeasures that can be executed automatically, if you will. I mean, conceptually, I think that's the way where we need to go. Any given process and who can implement it and how they implement it is a slightly different issue. But conceptually, to match the pace of the threat, we need to be doing things that are machine speed.
So yeah, I'll offer a little bit of skepticism on DARPA going for automated response to these cyber threats. The fundamental problem that you see, and I've seen it across a lot of the efforts being done in predictive analytics, an awful lot of the new AI work that's being done, you're trying to train a system against a standard. It comes all the way back out to assessment, because my assessment will set my policy of what I'm going to protect, will set the rules that I want to enforce, and then you're releasing an autonomous system to try and go make that outcome happen. If you don't get it right with the back-end data or with the examples that you're working with, then you will find the system spiraling off in directions, and a smart human will then be able to figure out a path that will bypass it. So fundamentally, the reason why I have skepticism is not that there isn't value that these systems will contribute. It's that these systems are no substitute for creating a culture of security, for getting buy-in from the people that are involved in the system, and guiding the process forward. You can't get around the people, and what gets me nervous every time talking in security conferences is people trying to find technical ways to get around the user and get around the people.
And Kirsten and Joe really hit on the fact that it does come back to the fact that we can have automated response, we can have, you know, automated capabilities, but we still need to have the governance and policy in place. So I live in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Uber has driverless cars right now going around the city. It's a fantastic and exciting venture, but when I look around what is the infrastructure and what are the policies, the governmental policies, the safety policies, those are not in place yet. And so it's the exact same thing with automated response. We're going to need to have policies and standards in place, and it does come back to people.
Well, unfortunately, we've run out of time. The clock has hit all zeros. However, we will all be around at the conference, and we hope if you do have questions that you'll approach us and we can have those individual conversations. But thanks very much, Yanming, Summer, Kirsten, and Joe. We hope you enjoyed this morning's discussion. We hope it was insightful. And again, thanks so much to Jim and to WITSA and the WCIT staff, and certainly to those of you in the audience today and those of you who have been watching from around the globe online. Thank you.